We have worked in this course so far to get to this point. We've talked about making genomes and mRNAs. And today we're going to talk about taking those messenger RNAs and making protein out of them. So we're going to talk about protein synthesis or translation. I really want to call this lecture Lost in Translation, right? But I don't want you to be lost. You shouldn't be lost, because it's not that hard. So here we are with mRNA, the goal of the Baltimore scheme. All viruses have to make mRNA because the protein synthesis machinery that they use is that of the cell. None of them can translate proteins on their own. So we're going to talk about how viruses utilize this system, how they their genomes are translated, how they modify it, how they do things differently from the host, and how they inhibit the host. They would like to have the whole translation machinery at their disposal. They don't want any host mRNAs being translated. So we're going to talk about how viruses do that. And of course, the host knows that there's a virus in it, and the host is trying to prevent viral translation. So there's this constant arms race. We'll talk a little bit about that, and we're going to pick that up again when we talk about immunology. So an mRNA, a typical mRNA, has a couple of features. You probably know most of this basic stuff if you've taken an introductory bio course, but we need to refresh it to make sure we all understand the same things. Here's a typical messenger RNA on the top. The 5' end, it has a cap structure. We've talked about this already during the transcription lecture. This is a base, typically a G, which is linked to the first base of the mRNA, but by an unusual 5' to 5' linkage rather than a 5 to 3', which is characteristic of the rest of the molecule. You see there are 3 phosphates in here. It can also be methylated. It's methylated on the first base and sometimes on the next two bases in the RNA as well. So it's found on most eukaryotic mRNAs. Most viral RNAs are capped, but not all of them. We'll see why today. And it's important for processing of the mRNA turnover. And it's also, as we will see today, required for efficient translation of mRNAs. So that's the cap structure. And of course, the mRNA also has an open reading frame that begins with usually an AUG codon, but not always. And then there's a stop codon that encodes the protein. They're typically 5' and 3' untranslated regions. That's what UTR stands for. And there's a poly-A tail. Not all viruses have poly-A tails. The poly-A tail has a certain function, and viruses choose to do it in a different way, some viruses anyway. So the 5' untranslated region is typically 50 to 70 nucleotides, but some are very long. They often have secondary structure. And as you will see, ribosomes need to pass through this region to get to the translation initiation codon, which is that AUG codon. And secondary structure, that is base paired RNA, stem loop structures, that will impede the ribosome. So that has to be dealt with, has to be unwound, as you will see. So the length of this region and the secondary structure can influence translation efficiency. And so an mRNA in your cell, if it doesn't need to be translated very often, if the protein is catalytic, so you don't need a lot of it, it can have a lot of secondary structure in the 5' end as a way of modulating how much protein is made. The 3' UTR can also regulate translation initiation because, as you will see, we think that mRNA is actually translated as a closed loop. And the poly-A tail is also necessary for efficient translation. The translational machinery consists of ribosomes, or flying turkeys over here, which, of course, are protein RNA assemblies. In eukaryotic cells, there are 40 and 60 S subunits, and both are made up of ribosomal RNAs and proteins. And of course, it's the RNA that carries out the catalysis. This is probably a remnant of the RNA world where everything was RNA. tRNAs are also part of the translational machinery. Of course, these are the adapters that read the genetic code at one end of the molecule and insert the right amino acid that's attached to the tRNA. And of course, there are enzymes, tRNA synthetases, that put the amino acids on up here. We'll talk a little bit about the termination process of protein synthesis in terms of tRNAs. And then there are also a lot of other proteins that are needed. They're called initiation proteins. In eukaryotes, they're called EIFs, eukaryotic initiation factors, elongation proteins, and termination proteins. And they were called factors at one time because we didn't know what they were. We know now they're proteins, but people can't change their ways. When they name something, they're stuck. So they're called, which I despise factor. I think it's so vague. It means nothing. We should call these initiation proteins. That's why I write proteins here. And people get mad at me because I'm changing the nomenclature. So that's what I mean by initiation, elongation, and termination proteins. And we'll talk about what some of these do. I don't need you to memorize this whole initiation scheme, but I'd like you to know what viruses do to mess with it. Okay, so I would never give you a blank version of this and say label the proteins. It's useless. I want you to know what they're doing. Okay, so here's how initiation of translation works in eukaryotic cells. It's called 5' end dependent initiation because it requires a cap structure at the 5' end. And you'll see some viruses don't do this. That's why I'm going through the trouble of explaining this to you. So what we have first are 40 S subunits free in the cytoplasm of the cell. These are bound to a few initiation proteins called EIF4A and EIF3. This 40 S ribosome then binds what's called a ternary complex, which is composed of the initiator tRNA, the methionine. So that's the first amino acid that's going to be put down on the protein, a molecule of GTP bound to EIF2 and EIF1. So three components. The EIF2 is one component, the tRNA, and the EIF1. So that's why it's called a ternary component. This will be important later. We're going to talk about regulation, how translation is regulation. This is going to be a focus of regulation. So this binds the 40S, so you get this 43S pre-initiation complex. And then another molecule called EIF4G comes here. This is a red one in the back there. And it's got EIF4A attached to it. And you'll see this is important later on when we talk about regulation as well. And finally, this whole complex binds the 5' end of the messenger RNA through a protein called EIF4E. A better name for this protein is cap binding protein, because that's what it does. It binds the 5' cap on the messenger RNA. If you take the cap off of the mRNA, that protein will not bind, and it can't be translated. That's why we call this cap-dependent or 5' end-dependent initiation. The cap is essential, because look what it does. It binds EIF4E. 4E, in turn, binds EIF4G. It's kind of hidden here, but the C-terminus of 4E is binding the N-terminus of EIF4G. And that brings in the whole complex. So 4G is like a scaffold. It links 4E with the rest of this complex. Really, the most important part is the 40S subunit. And that is linked to EIF4G through this protein called EIF3. So essentially, what I want you to get away from this is not the names of the proteins, but the fact that the cap is what brings the ribosome, the 40S ribosomal subunit, to the mRNA so that it can begin to be translated. And of course, the initiating codon is usually a ways away from the 5' end. It's 50 to 70 bases, maybe more, depending on the mRNA. So now this complex has to get there. All right, so that's the first step of initiation. Here's a little information on EIF4G, which is the red protein. Here I've taken away on the bottom some of the other proteins, so you can see how 4E and 4G are interacting. So again, 4E is the cap-binding protein. It binds the mRNA, and it brings in everything else. It binds 4G here. 4G binds EIF3, and 3 binds the 40S subunits. And I think the reason why it's complicated is to allow regulation. You can regulate translation by changing the levels of any of these proteins. This is 4G at the top here, just to show you. It's a multifunctional protein. This is quite large. It's about 220,000 Daltons in size. And it has a N-terminus here. There's a binding site for poly-A binding protein. We'll see what that is all about in a moment. Here's the EIF4E binding site. There's a binding site for EIF3 and also for EIF4A. EIF4A is this green protein here. This is an RNA helicase. This unwinds double-stranded RNA. This is important because as this complex is moving through the 5' untranslated region, whenever it encounters some secondary structure, which by definition is double-stranded, this helicase will melt it. So a helicase rips apart the two strands so that the ribosome can go by. So that's an important protein to bring in, and EIF4G brings in that as well. So 4G is very important. In fact, 4G was discovered because a virus turns out to cleave it. And the cleavage happens here where this broken line is. We're going to talk about that later. We had no clue about 4G until someone found that a certain virus shut off translation in a cell, and the mechanism is to cleave 4G, which totally makes it unable to serve this scaffolding role. So a really neat protein and an important one. So now we've got this big complex on the mRNA. This is called a 48S initiation complex. And it starts to move down towards the AUG. That's called scanning. The whole thing moves, or part of it moves. We're not really quite sure how much of it moves. But obviously, it has to at some point detach from the cap. And exactly when that happens, no one really knows. So let's just say part of the complex moves down towards the AUG. If there is secondary structure here, as shown by this schematic stem loop, the helicase activity of EIF4A will melt it out. If there's no secondary structure, then you don't really need 4A. Eventually, so the scanning requires energy, as you can see here by hydrolysis of ATP. Eventually, the 40S subunit will reach the AUG codon, which is shown here in green, and the methionine, the anticodon of the methionine tRNA is UAC, so those base pair, and that signals that initiation can begin. So most of these protein factors fall away. As you can see here, EIF2, 5, 3, etc. Another factor comes in called EIF5, and what that does is helps the 60S subunit to join to the 40S right there on the AUG codon, and now you're ready to start translating. All right, so the 60S subunit joining doesn't occur until the AUG codon is reached. And then everything is positioned for initiation. You have the methionine tRNA there. And now you can add the next amino acid, which is going to be added to the A site as soon as I recharge my pointer here. All right, let's take a look at how this happens. Oh, first, I have to tell you about circularization. So we've got the ribosome, the full ribosome, 60S and 40S subunits bound at the AUG. I've shown you this all in a linear fashion, but we think it actually happens as a circular mRNA. There's a lot of good evidence, biochemical and genetic evidence, that the 3' end of the mRNA is actually bound to this 5' complex. And it's bound in this way. The 3' end, of course, is polyadenylated. I'm only showing two A's here, but there are 200 or so. That sequence is bound to a protein called poly-A binding protein, PABP. And poly-A binding protein binds the N-terminus of EIF4G. So you may remember from a previous slide, I show you at the N-terminus of 4G a PABP binding site, and that's why that's there. And this effectively circularizes the mRNA. And if you disrupt this, if you get rid of PABP or you make mutations in it so it can't bind 4G or make 4G mutations so it can't bind PABP, all of these decrease translational efficiency. We think this is circular so that when ribosomes reach the end, they can rapidly get back on the 5' end and translate some more. But we're not really sure the real reason for that. Circular mRNA. All right, so let's go to our first question, which I think is already up there. Right. So this, which is incorrect about the 5' cap on mRNA? Which most of you got. Some of you got number one. Let's see what that's about. So number one, it consists of M7G joined to the second nucleotide of mRNA by an unusual 5' to 5' phosphodiester linking. That's true. That's exactly what it is. Okay. It's present on most cellular mRNAs, correct. It's required for efficient translation, correct. It binds the cap binding protein, that's correct. This is what's wrong. It's found on mRNA but not pre-mRNA. It's made co-transcriptionally. It's added to the mRNA co-transcriptionally. After about 20 or 30 bases of mRNA is made in the nucleus by Pol2, then the cap is added. So it's on pre-mRNA before it's spliced. And in fact, it's thought to be important for the splicing reaction. All right, so that was a little overview of how translation works in eukaryotic cells. And what I want to tell you next is how viruses have changed this process to suit their decoding of their genome. So we're going to look at a couple of different mechanisms that are virus-specific as far as we know. First one is called ribosome shunting. So what I've told you so far is that ribosomes bind the 5' cap, and then they scan to reach the first AUG codon. So here's an experiment where we've made three different mRNAs, and we're translating these in vitro or in a cell, and we're looking at the protein product. And these are the protein products of this translation. There happen to be two of them, but the point is that these are readouts for the protein that is being made. So here at the top is the wild-type mRNA, and you can see when you translate it, you get the protein made, so this is working. If you put a insertion here at the 3' end, this red insertion is a very stable stem loop structure. It has a stability of negative 80 kilocalories per mole. That means it's very stable. And this is thought to be stable enough to impede ribosomes from moving through it. Even though the initiation complex has a helicase, it can't unwind this. This is too much. Beyond a certain stability, beyond about minus 70 kilocalories per mole, the helicase cannot unwind it. All right, so if you put this stem loop structure here just before the AUG, that's the 3' insertion, it doesn't have any effect on translation. So why is that? I just told you that the ribosomes have to pass through this region. Well, when people were doing these experiments, they were puzzled. And they did another one where they put the insertion up here, upstream of the naturally occurring secondary structure. So this RNA, which is a very special RNA, has a secondary structure within it. You put the stem loop upstream, that's the 5' insertion, it knocks out protein synthesis. So how can this be that you put one here, there's no effect at the 3' end, but at the 5' end it has an effect? Well, people eventually figured out that this is because the ribosomes bind to the 5' cap, and they have to scan a little bit. They have to move along the RNA till they get to this first secondary structure. And then they bypass it all. They just go over it in some way. They don't actually leap over it, but it's a nice metaphor. And they go right to the AUG. So they go somewhere from one of these first stem loops to the AUG. They bypass all of this. They're not actually scanning through it. That's why it was called shunting. And here's a schematic of that on the next slide. So we're just showing the ribosome, the 40S subunit for simplicity here. It's bound the cap, it's scanning, it gets to that first stem loop, and then it's passed along the tops of the loops here to the 40S subunit. And there's some kind of direct translocation occurring here. And the exact mechanism isn't clear, but it certainly does not involve scanning. So just think of it being passed in a crowd of people holding up a person. They're passing the person over the crowd. And it's not touching the floor at all. So these are being passed along the tops of these stem loop structures. Of course, this RNA is all wrapped up in a very complex loop. So this is probably passing over the top of it. So this explains why the results were obtained in the previous experiment. The ribosome has to scan to that first stem loop. So if you put secondary structure in front of it, that's inhibited. So that blocks translation. If you put the secondary structure down here, it doesn't matter because the ribosome is passing over it. It's not actually scanning through it. And so these have been found, RNAs with this property of ribosome shunting have been found in a number of viruses shown here. The cauliflower mosaic virus, which we talked about last time, the plant virus with the reverse transcriptase, an adenovirus, and a paramyxovirus, Sendai virus. And we think that viruses utilize shunting to decrease the need for that 5' end helicase, essentially. So there are some cases where viruses inhibit 5' end translation, so the helicase is not available to them for their translation. So they use this kind of mechanism to get around that. So that's called ribosome shunting. The second kind of unusual translation I want to tell you about was discovered in the genome of poliovirus and bicornavirus. And when this genome sequence was determined, shown at the top here, a very long 5' untranslated region was discovered. So here's the RNA genome of polio. It's a plus-stranded RNA. It has a single long open reading frame that encodes for one long protein. That protein is translated and processed by viral proteases. There are 5 and 3 prime untranslated regions. This RNA is polyadenylated. It doesn't have a cap at the 5 prime end. It has VPG, which is the primer for RNA synthesis. If you remember from our RNA synthesis lecture, that VPG with 2 U's on it is used as the primer. So it ends up being attached to the viral mRNA. There's no cap. So that's the first clue that something is different. When the genome was sequenced, here's the first 800 or so bases of the genome. You can see the AUG codon for initiation is right there. But before it is about 740 bases of untranslated region. And this, combined with the fact that there was no cap on the 5 prime end, seemed fishy. People were wondering how ribosomes actually found this methionine with such a long 5 prime UTR and with no cap. How did the ribosome get to the RNA in the first place? So the idea arose that maybe the ribosomes go right to the cap, right to the AUG without a cap. And so the following experiment was done to try and address that possibility. So here are two different mRNAs that were constructed. These are artificial mRNAs. They're both capped, and they have a 5 prime UTR and a 3 prime end. They're polyadenylated, but they have 2 genes in them, or 2 open reading frames. This shows you how old this experiment is, because these are old genes that nobody uses anymore, the TK and the CAT gene. Back then, they were used because there were antibodies against them, and you could assay their production in this experiment. Nowadays, you would use luciferase or something like that. Anyway, the point here is that if you put this mRNA into a cell, you don't make a lot of, you make a lot of the first protein, but very little of the second. In general, as we will see, eukaryotic mRNAs typically encode only one protein. Ribosomes will translate it, and then they will fall off after the stop codon, and very few go on to reinitiate, but you get a little bit of the second protein made here. Now, if you replace the sequence between the 2 open reading frames with the 5 prime untranslated region of poliovirus, the virus I just showed you, let's go back to that. So you take this whole sequence and you make an RNA with that in the middle flanked by 2 protein coding genes. That's what we have here, and it's labeled IRES. Now, if you put this in cells, both proteins are made abundantly, not only the first one, but the second one as well. And this confirmed the idea that ribosomes can actually bind to this 5 prime UTR of poliovirus and initiate translation. So these ribosomes that are translating this CAT gene are not actually CAT mRNA or open reading frame, are not actually scanning through from the TK. They are initiating right at the AUG of the CAT gene. So to prove that, the second set of experiments was done, shown on the bottom here. These were done in poliovirus-infected cells. And in these cells, the initiation of translation at the cap is inhibited completely. We'll see the mechanism of that later. But basically, ribosomes cannot load onto the 5' end because cap-dependent or 5' end-dependent translation is completely inhibited. So if you take this mRNA and put it into polio-infected cells, you get 0 protein of any sort. You can't make this protein at all, and you can't make the second one because no ribosomes are scanning through. If you use this construct with the 5' UTR of poliovirus in the middle, you don't make the first protein, the TK, again, because ribosomes cannot load on the 5' end, but you do make the CAT protein, and that's because the ribosomes can bind internally in this sequence initiate translation. So this sequence is called the internal ribosome entry site for that reason, because the ribosomes bind internally. They don't require a 5' cap or a 5' end to initiate translation. So the guiding principle here is an iris does not require a 5' end. So to actually test that, the next experiment was done, and that is to make circular mRNAs. So if you really need a 5' end, well, you do need a 5' end for cap-dependent or 5' end-dependent translation, but if an iris really can bring ribosomes internally without a 5' end, then if you have an iris in a circular RNA, it should be translated. So here we have 2 circular RNAs that encode a protein, an initiator codon, and a stop codon on each one. And in one, we have an internal ribosome entry site from polio, and in the other, we just have some other sequence. And if you translate these, this on the right without the iris doesn't make any protein. Ribosomes cannot access this open reading frame because there's no 5' end. They need to load on a cap structure. But the iris does not require a 5' end, and therefore protein can be made from this circular mRNA. So this was very revealing back in the 80s when these experiments were done. This was a brand new mechanism of initiation of translation which didn't require a cap. And we have since found irises in many different viral genomes. And if you happen to look in the literature, you will see that there are many papers which claim that there are irises in cellular genes as well. But this is a highly controversial field, and some people believe there are, and others believe they're not. But certainly in viral genomes, there are irises. There are many different kinds, and they're functional. And here are four different types of iris that are simply found in four different kinds of viruses. The one I just told you about is that of poliovirus. It's called a type 1 iris. Here's a different one from a different set of viruses called the type 2. A third one from hepatitis C virus, and then one from an insect picornavirus. And you can see these are highly structured. In fact, they have no sequences in common. There's no way you can look for an iris by sequence. There's just simply no sequence consensus. It's the secondary structure that is, in fact, important for conveying the ability of the ribosomes to bind internally. And so, for example, how these work is that, in this case, it's been shown that EIF4G binds right here to this structure in the RNA. And as you may remember, when 4G is present, then the ribosome can bind to that via EIF3. So this sequence somehow makes it very attractive for EIF4G to bind. You don't need a 5' cap to do that. And the other irises work in somewhat similar fashions. They have a lot of secondary structure that can attract components of the translation system, so you don't need a 5' cap. All right, so that's the key here. The iris depends on RNA secondary structure to attract translation machinery without the need for a cap or EIF4E, which is the cap-binding protein. So I told you earlier about how most cellular mRNAs are translated. The 5' end is required because of the cap attracts the translational machinery. Two of the irises, the type 1 and the 2 iris, require all of these initiation proteins. They don't need EIF4E. EIF4E is the cap binding protein. These irises do not need it because 4G is thought to bind directly to the secondary structure, as I showed you on the previous slide. All right, and here is a hint of what's to come. In cells infected with picornaviruses, EIF4G is cleaved, but it doesn't matter for the function of the iris. The iris will still bind 4G even when the N-terminus is cleaved. Of course, this 4G can no longer bind 4E, and that's why it doesn't bind or recognize a cap any longer. The hep C virus iris is quite interesting. It's unusual because it only needs two of the initiation proteins, EIF2 and EIF3. It doesn't need EIF4G at all, and this can move to the AUG. In fact, the 40S subunit plus EIF3 sits down right at the AUG and can begin translating. So this is really an RNA sequence that has evolved to attract the translation machinery on its own. It's probably a very old sequence, perhaps even dating from the RNA world. So number 5 is mostly selected, and that's correct. They are viral mechanisms for decoding mRNAs, that's correct. Both shunting and irises are for viral genomes. They involve RNA secondary structures, absolutely. I showed you the shunting requires the secondary structures, the iris requires the secondary structures. 5' cap is essential for both. It's not essential for both. It's essential for the shunt, but not for the iris. So the answer is 1 and 2. It's just viral mechanisms involve RNA secondary structures. So by either 5' end dependent or ribosome shunting or iris mediated initiation, we now have a 60S ribosome at the AUG codon. The MET tRNA is positioned. That's called the P site because that's where the peptide bond is actually made once the second amino acid is added. The next amino acid is going to go into the A site. Next charged tRNA is going to go in the A site depending on the triplet that's there, of course. And then once that gets linked to the first amino acid, the ribosome, will move a codon, and the used tRNA will be in the exit site, and it will be discarded. So that's why these sites are named A, P, and E. Now, so far I've told you about initiation requiring this AUG codon and a methionine tRNA. But not too long ago in viruses, some very interesting examples of methionine-independent initiation were discovered. So the first amino acid is not a methionine always. It can be something else. And here are the mechanisms of that. So one is shown in part A here at the top. This is a RNA of a insect, the coronavirus. It's actually an iris. So in other words, ribosomes can bind internally. These don't need a cap for translation. But what I want to tell you here is that the way this RNA folds mimics a methionine initiator tRNA. So it sits in the P site of the ribosome. And this has a particular anticodon that matches up with this codon, which happens to be proline. So this protein is not beginning with a methionine. It's not even beginning with a proline. It's beginning with this RNA sitting in it. The ribosome says, there's a met tRNA here, and it starts making protein. So the next amino acid that goes in here will be the one encoded by this triplet. And it won't be a methionine. So here, in this case, GCU is not a methionine. So these all are, this is a way to make a protein that doesn't have a methionine as the first amino acid, because the viral RNA is mimicking that first met tRNA. So this means that there can be, you can miss proteins if you just look for open reading frames followed by a methionine. And that's what a lot of bioinformaticians do. They sequence a genome and say, how many MET-initiated open reading frames are there? And I think you're going to miss some if you do that, because here in viral genomes, we know that a number of proteins can be made without methionine. Here's another example at the bottom, also a viral RNA genome. This happens to be a plant virus RNA. I think this is really neat also. So this happens to be a capped mRNA. So this attracts the initiation complex via the cap. But again, it's not initiated with methionine. The 3' end of this viral RNA folds to mimic a valine tRNA. And in fact, it is charged with valine. So the viral RNA is charged with valine. That means valine is attached to the tRNA here by tRNA synthetases. And this base pairs in the P site of the ribosome. The ribosome thinks it's a met tRNA. It begins to make a protein, but it's initiated with valine in this case. So two examples of how you can get non-methionine initiating protein synthesis. Now, I show you this because, you know, for years the dogma was you have an AUG and you start protein synthesis with that. But viruses break this dogma, and I'll bet there are genes in eukaryotic genomes that don't begin with methionine as well. So if you ever see the estimate that there are 20 or 30 or 40,000 genes in the human genome, that's based on methionine initiating open reading frames. So it may be an underestimate. So this is the virus that initiates without a methionine, the first one that I showed you earlier. This happens to be a insect picornavirus called cricket paralysis virus. So this is the polio virus of crickets. And in fact, it was discovered by farmers in Australia who found paralyzed crickets in their field, and eventually they found the virus in them. And this is the virus they pulled out, cricket paralysis virus. And it very much looks like a picornavirus. Here's a diagram of the genome. It is a plus-stranded RNA with VPG at the 5' end. It has an open reading frame. This one happens to be broken into two open reading frames. So if this were polio, there would be just one open reading frame. It's polyadenylated. So there's an iris at the 5' end here, because this RNA doesn't have a cap, so it needs some other way to translate, so it does so via an iris. And this second open reading frame has in front of it an iris as well. So there are two irises. Ribosomes bind internally at the first open reading frame and at the second. The second one, you can see, doesn't begin with an AUG codon. It begins with a CCU, which is base pairing with the viral RNA itself to mimic a met tRNA in the P site of the ribosome. So that's where that structure that I previously showed you is located in the viral genome right there. This is an overview of what the viral RNA actually looks like. The 5' iris is highly structured. Then there's the ORF1 encoding a protein. Then in the middle is another iris, which folds in a different way. which allows this structure to sit in the P side of the ribosome, and then the protein is made from that part. So again, two cool ways for initiating without methionine. Now, there is a general problem in eukaryotic mRNAs, and that is you can usually only make one protein per mRNA. So we say that eukaryotic genomes are typically monocistronic. They encode one cistron, which is an old genetic term for a single open reading frame. But you can think of it as encoding just one protein. So you have an AUG and a stop codon, one protein. And that's in contrast to bacteria and archaeal mRNAs, which are polycistronic. They can have one mRNA with several open reading frames in them. And each one can be translated. And this works because each AUG has around it the so-called Sheindel-Garneau sequence, this short sequence that is complementary to ribosomal RNAs that can recruit the ribosome. So you can think of these as the irises of bacteria and archaea. These sequences around the AUG attract the ribosome and allow you to have multiple proteins made from one mRNA. So for the most part, this doesn't happen in eukaryotic cells. You just typically get monocistronic mRNAs. But viruses have an issue because they have many of them have small genomes, and many of them have only one mRNA, so they can't just make one protein. They have to figure out ways to make multiple proteins from an mRNA. So I want to tell you about some ways that viruses have evolved to overcome the monocistronic rule, the one mRNA, one protein limitation. So there are ways to make mRNAs multicistronic, and that's what I want to tell you about now. So here are all the ways that you can make a lot of proteins from a viral genome. I don't want to tell you about all of them. We have talked about a few of them so far in this course. For example, we've talked about polyproteins. You have, for example, the coronaviruses, as well as many other virus families. If you have one mRNA, you're not limited to one protein. You can make a long precursor and chop it up with enzymes. So you're chopping up the protein and getting multiple proteins from a single one. You can have subgenomic mRNAs, so the negative strand viruses are good at that. They make lots of small mRNAs from a single RNA. And even some of the plus strand viruses do that as well. You can have segmented genomes. So influenza rotaviruses solve the problem by making genomes in pieces, so each piece can encode one protein. RNA splicing is another way. And then internal initiation, as you saw for that cricket paralysis virus, you can make two precursor proteins from a single mRNA. And today we'll talk about a few other mechanisms. We'll talk about leaky scanning, reinitiation. I think we'd talk about that. I'm not sure if I took that slide out or not. We'll see. But that's one mechanism where you can make multiple proteins from an mRNA. We'll talk about termination suppression and ribosomal frame shifting. So these are really interesting workarounds that have evolved in virus systems to get around the one mRNA, one protein rule. So polyprotein synthesis, you should know this happens in a number of the viruses we've talked about. And this is an obvious way to get multiple proteins from a single message. Here's the message of picornaviruses. That's, of course, the genome and the main or the only mRNA. But the virus needs about a dozen proteins. So the solution here is very simple. You make a long protein, and then you cut it up with proteases, with enzymes. And the enzymes are buried in this precursor. They're called here 2A and 3C. And those enzymes, as soon as they're synthesized by the ribosome, can clip themselves out of the polyprotein and then start attacking other polyproteins as they're made. So the result is you get about a dozen individual proteins, enzymes for RNA synthesis, capsid proteins, and so forth. So it's a very simple solution. Here's another example of a polyprotein. These are flaviviruses that have plus-stranded RNA genomes. Again, they make a long precursor, and they cut it up. These viruses use a slightly different approach. They use a combination of viral proteases. So the NS3 is the viral protease that chops up these yellow bonds here. But the virus also uses a host cell protease, the signalase that cuts signal peptides off of the N-termini of secreted proteins. The virus uses that to process its polyprotein. So straightforward, make a lot of proteins from one mRNA by processing a polyprotein. Here is another example called leaky scanning, which I really like because in the paramyxoviruses, which make multiple mRNAs, this allows you to make multiple proteins from a single mRNA. Okay, so you can make six mRNAs from a negative strand genome, say. Each of those could make a protein. So you could make six proteins. Well, what if you want to make more? Here's one way to do that. So this mRNA is capped, like all of the other viral mRNAs, and it has a main open reading frame here encoding this P protein. But it also makes a number of other proteins. It makes a bunch of different C proteins, which are shown down here. It makes a V protein via editing. So the editing, remember the post-transcriptional editing, you add an extra base that allows you to make a different protein as well. And then there's a protein way down here. So let's see how it works. So the ribosomes bind the cap and they start to scan. And they reach the first triplet ACG. So sometimes ACG can serve as an initiation codon. What happens is the methionine tRNA will base pair with it. So ACG will base pair with the anticodon. It's not great. It's not a great fit, but it can work. That's not retrovirus. All right, so the first ACG at base 81 is not a good initiator. So some of the ribosomes initiate and you make this protein called C prime, but many of them keep going because they don't really like to initiate it in an ACG. And then they reach this AUG at 104. So we're just scanning down the 5 prime end, and 104 ends up making this long protein, 568, the 568 amino acid P protein. This is an AUG, but it's not in a good context. One of the things I haven't told you is that the sequences surrounding an AUG will affect the efficiency of initiation. So even though the ribosomes recognize this as an AUG, the surrounding sequences aren't optimal. So a number of them keep scanning as well. And then they reach an AUG at 114, not only an AUG, but it's in a good context. It's in a good sequence context. So the rest of the ribosomes initiate there. So you've got so far three different polypeptides from this single mRNA. These two AUGs are farther away. They are reached by ribosome shunting. So a fraction of the ribosomes will bind the cap and then pass over all these other AUGs and get delivered to either the one at 183 or 2 or 1. That gives you two different additional polypeptides. So we have five so far. The W and the V are made by RNA editing. And I think the X is also made by shunting as well. So one mRNA, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 protein, 8 different proteins. So you can get a lot of flexibility by fooling with just the initiation codon and the sequence surrounding it. So that's called leaky scanning. So just because there's an AUG doesn't mean all the ribosomes are going to stop there. It depends on the context. Another neat mechanism for making more than one protein from a single mRNA is ribosomal frame shifting, okay, and that's shown here. I'm sorry, this is not ribosomal frame shifting. This is suppression of termination. I'm so excited about frame shifting that I want to tell you about it right now. This is a good one also, but this is more common. So at the end of translation, you have your last codon specifying an amino acid. Here's the growing polypeptide chain, all linked, amino acids linked together. Then you have a termination codon. It can be UAA, UAG, or UGA. The way termination works is that termination proteins called ERF1 and ERF3 recognize the termination codon. These proteins, in particular ERF1, they look very much like tRNAs. So they fit into the A site of the ribosome, but they're not charged with amino acids. And so the protein synthesis machinery stops, so the ribosome doesn't move anymore. The protein is released and the subunits dissociate. Sometimes these stop codons can be recognized by tRNAs with amino acids on them. So they can be recognized by special tRNAs. For example, there is a tRNA that recognizes UGA, one of the stop codons, and it has selenocysteine linked to it. It's a very unusual, rare amino acid. But that, of course, puts an amino acid in and lets you make a longer protein because the reading frame could continue until another stop codon is encountered. So you can make a different protein. And this doesn't happen 100% of the time. It's typically 5 to 10% of the time. So you can get two different proteins from a single mRNA. Sometimes normal tRNAs can misread these stop codons. So a tRNA encoding any amino acid can misread it. and get in there. And nothing is perfect in biology, so sometimes you have amino acids of other sorts being put in there, and again, that makes a longer protein. So this is used by a couple of viruses. Here are two examples where termination suppression is important. The retrovirus genome. Remember, the retrovirus genome has this long single mRNA that encodes the structural and the non-structural proteins, the GAG proteins, and the reverse transcriptase and integrase. And for some retroviruses, this is accessed, the polymerase is accessed by making a spliced mRNA. But for others, it's accessed by frame shifting. So at the end of the GAG polyprotein, there's a stop codon right there, UAG, and mostly GAG is produced. But a fraction of the time, this gets suppressed by misreading amino acid is put in, so you get a GAG-pol fusion, which can then be processed to make the individual proteins that you need. And this structure here, called a pseudonaut, where the open part of an RNA stem loop base pairs with a downstream sequence. This is important for the suppression. The idea is that the ribosomes bump into this, and they're there for a brief moment, longer than usual, and at that time the wrong tRNA can go into this suppression site. Because if you remove this stem loop, you don't get any more suppression. There's an example in the alpha virus genome. These are viruses with plus-stranded RNAs. I don't know if you remember this, but these are translated only to produce this initial P123 protein. There's a stop codon here. The rest of the structural proteins that are encoded here are made from a negative, from a subgenomic mRNA produced from a negative strand. But this protein here can be extended just a little bit more by read-through suppression at this stop codon. And this actually gives you the RNA polymerase, which is needed to replicate the genome to give you the negative strand RNA, so you can make the subgenomic RNA to make the structural protein. So two examples of suppression in viral genomes, and there are more. Okay, now ribosomal frame shifting. This is really neat. This also happens in retroviral genomes. Remember, you have to get GAG, the structural proteins, and polymerase proteins made. I showed you in some retroviruses it's done by suppression. In others, it's done by splicing. And still others, it's done by a ribosomal frame shift. So here's the genomic mRNA. So it's a full-length mRNA. It goes from LTR to LTR. It can be translated to produce the GAG protein. Then there's a stop codon right there. And that gives you this protein here, which is great, but you have to somehow access the pol region. Otherwise, you don't make reverse transcriptase, and you would not be able to make an infectious particle. So how is that made? It's made by ribosomal frame shifting. The ribosomes get here, and they back up one base. They change their reading frame, and then they continue. And this happens about 5 to 10% of the time. So you don't need a lot of pol because it's an enzyme. It's catalytic. You don't need a ton of it as you do for structural proteins. And that's frame shifting is what does it. Let's see if we can see how this works. So on the upper left is a ribosome translating at the end of the GAG protein of the retrovirus. All right, so here's the stop codon, UAG. It's just put in a leucine here. And normally the ribosome would move the UAG into the A site. It would be terminated, and then you would have a GAG protein. But again, 5 to 10% of the time, the ribosome slips back one base. So that's shown here. All right, so look at the AAU paired with the UUA. Here it has slipped back one. And it still doesn't do badly in terms of base pairing. Okay, there's a mismatch here, of course, the UU. But that's okay. These tend to happen in these AU-rich areas. They're actually called slippery sequences. They're conducive to this sort of thing. So now we've slipped back. The polypeptide is transferred. And you can put in a new tRNA into this site, where normally you would have a stop codon UAG. Now you can recognize AUA, the complement is the tRNA for isoleucine. And so you're putting a new amino acid in there, which will continue the synthesis. Okay, so I went wrong with this. It's actually going down this way and then peptide transfer. So here we have the almost finished polypeptide. We slip back one base. And then this amino acid leucine is transferred over to the growing chain, or the chain is transferred to the leucine. And then the next tRNA is put in. So you can see, instead of having a stop codon, you insert a new amino acid, and this will go as long as the frame lasts. And for the retroviruses, the reading frame goes to the end of the Pol gene. There's no other stop codons in here. So this is a calculated way to make that protein that you need. Ribosomal frame shifting. Number three, there you go. Now, all of the above, some people are getting all of the above, so let's go through that. It's not all of the above. Does not require an AUG. They both require AUG start codons. Does not bind the 40. I can understand why you might say no, because I've told you about non-AUG start codons, but it's not the best answer. Does not bind the 40S ribosomal subunit. That's not true. Has only one open reading frame. That's the answer. That's the definition of a monocistronic RNA. Is only found in viruses and bacteria. Is not correct. So most of the, as far as we know, the polycistronics of bacteria require an AUG. I haven't told you that, but that's one of the things that would make that incorrect. All right, let's end up by talking about regulation of translation. And this is a table I took from a paper which reviewed all the ways that translation can be regulated at the stages of initiation, elongation, and termination. And I've color-coded them here. So the blue ones are initiation, the magenta ones are elongation, and termination is green. So you can see that by far, initiation is the regulated step in translation as far as we know. So let me tell you about how translation can be regulated. There is a response that cells make to being infected, which is to turn off translation. So cells can sense a virus infection. We will talk about that in a couple of weeks. We talk about innate immune responses. And one of the ways that they respond is to shut down translation. All right, so here is the initiation step of protein synthesis. We have a ternary complex being added to the 40S subunit. It's bound to the mRNA. Now, you remember when the 60S subunit comes in, this GTP is hydrolyzed, the ternary complex falls off. So what you end up having is a molecule of EIF2 linked to GDP. And this has to be replaced with GTP. You need GTP to do another cycle of translation. And so this protein is bound by a protein called EIF2B, which is basically a guanine exchange factor. It takes the GDP and exchanges it for a molecule of GTP so that a new ternary complex can form and participate in another round of translation. This is an essential step, this replacement of GTP for GDP on the EIF2, because that's part of the ternary complex. One of the responses to virus infection, the cell makes a protein called PKR, protein kinase RNA activated, and what that does is to phosphorylate EIF2. So it puts a single phosphate onto EIF2. The result of that is when this EIF2 phosphate GDP binds EIF2B, can't be released. So this is stuck in EIF2B. So it can exchange GDP for GTP, but the EIF2 remains stuck in there, and eventually you don't have any, it actually sequesters all the EIF2B, and you can't recycle any of the GDP anymore, so you inhibit translation. So it's a very clever way to do this. It's a very important point of initiation, the replacement of GDP with GTP, and that's inhibited by a simple phosphorylation of EIF2. This is actually a normal cellular pathway that exists to regulate translation under certain conditions, and it also happens to be a defense against virus infection. The idea is virus infects the cell senses it, it makes this enzyme that phosphorylates EIF2, shuts down translation, the idea being you stop virus infection there. Maybe that cell will die, but the rest of the host will be spared. This enzyme PKR is very interesting. Here is a schematic of it. It has a catalytic or kinase domain, KD, linked to two RNA binding domains. As made in cells, this enzyme is not active. It can't phosphorylate anything until it gets activated. The way it gets activated is to phosphorylate itself first, and then it can phosphorylate EIF2. And it does so by being bound to double-stranded RNA. So here are two molecules of PKR bound to double-stranded RNA. They phosphorylate each other, and now they're active. They can go on and phosphorylate EIF2. So where does this double-stranded RNA comes from. It's not present in uninfected cells. It's typically produced in virus-infected cells. So either cells infected with RNA viruses or DNA viruses that are transcribing both strands of DNA, they can make double-stranded RNA. So virus infects the cell senses it, it makes PKR, then the virus makes double-stranded RNA, the double-stranded RNA activates PKR, and then that ends up shutting down translation. PKR is actually an interferon-induced gene. We will talk about that in a couple of weeks. Interferon is one of the early cytokines produced in response to virus infection. It turns on many other genes that are antiviral, and this is one of the main ones. So PKR is induced and activated by virus infection. This is just a summary of what I've told you. Its phosphorylation of EIF2 leads to inhibition of host translation. It also initiates apoptosis. So phosphorylation of EIF2 not only turns off translation, it turns on the apoptotic cycle, and it eventually kills the cell. This is such a powerful antiviral mechanism that every virus that exists that infects eukaryotic cells has to get around it in some way. And so they have evolved mechanisms to inactivate this PKR pathway. Every virus that we know of has at least one gene to deal with this. So here's how adenovirus does it. Adenovirus infects a cell, makes double-stranded RNA that could potentially activate PKR. PKR is induced because the cell senses the presence of adenovirus. So here we have PKR being made. It's inactive, right? The virus makes double-stranded RNA, which would lead to activation of PKR and phosphorylation of EIF2, protein synthesis inhibition. However, adenovirus makes another small double-stranded RNA called VaRNA1. It's very short. What it does is bind one molecule of PKR, only one molecule. So PKR cannot be next to another PKR and phosphorylate it. So PKR cannot be activated, so there's no phosphorylation of EIF2, protein synthesis continues. So adenovirus has evolved this mechanism to block the activity of PKR. It doesn't let it activate itself. And every virus does something in this same vein. The mechanisms are different, but the idea is to get around PKR. Here's what vaccinia virus does. Its genome encodes what are called pseudosubstrates. They look like EIF2 alpha. EIF2 is the component of the ternary complex that gets phosphorylated by PKR. Vaccinia virus makes a protein, makes two actually, one called K3L, one called M156R, that look just like the part of EIF2 alpha that gets phosphorylated. Here on the left is the structure of EIF2 alpha. Serine 51 is where it's phosphorylated. And you can see these two vaccinia proteins look just like this part of EIF2 alpha. So what happens is PKR phosphorylates them, and there's a ton of these proteins around in the virus-infected cell, and it never gets around to phosphorylating EIF2 alpha. So it's kind of it's taking attention away from the actual substrate, if you will. So every virus does something to mess with this PKR EIF2 alpha axis, and these are just, I want to show you this just to impress upon you the diversity of activities. These are all different targets and different viruses. So we have talked about adenovirus, which makes VaRNA that blocks activation by double-stranded RNA. But you can see there are various mechanisms that target EIF2 alpha. There are phosphatases that take the phosphate off. There are viruses that sequester their own double-stranded RNA, so it can't activate PKR. Every virus that we know of encodes some mechanism to get around PKR. That's how important it is. Number two has got the most. So that's correct. PKR is an interferon-induced enzyme that is activated by, it's not activated by GDP. It's activated by double-stranded RNA. And it phosphorylates EIF2 alpha, doesn't phosphorylate EIF2B. 2B gets locked in with phosphorylated EIF2 alpha. It's not activated by single-stranded RNA, and of course it's none of the above. So that's where that comes from. Now, viruses, that's a way that cells try to overcome viral translation, and the way viruses act back to overcome that. There's many viruses regulate cell translation. They try and shut off the host so that they can have the whole machinery dedicated to translating their mRNAs. They want to make maximal amounts of viral protein. So here's one way that this happens, which we've mentioned briefly. Many viruses encode proteases that cleave EIF4G right here. So that separates 4E from 4G. Now, if you remember, host mRNAs have a cap. They need to initiate translation with a cap binding protein, EIF4E, that helps recruit the 40S ribosome in. If you cleave right here, you can no longer recruit the ribosomal subunit to capped mRNAs. So that shuts off host translation. Now, why does virus translation still proceed? These viruses don't have caps on their mRNAs. They have an iris, remember. They have VPG and an iris, which lets the RNAs bind internally. They need 4G, but they don't need the M-terminus, because that's the part that binds 4E. So it's a brilliant way of shutting off the host and making sure that your mRNAs are translated as well. And the shutoff is shown here in an experiment. So if you infect cells with poliovirus and you look at the rate of protein synthesis with time, you can see in uninfected cells, the rate continues unabated. In infected cells, protein synthesis is shut off at around 2 hours after infection, and then it's replaced by viral protein synthesis. And if you label the proteins with a radioactive methionine and run them on a gel, you can see the shutoff happening very clearly at 3 and 5 and 7 hours post-infection. And the cell translation, which gives you the smear of cell proteins, there's so many of them, is replaced by a single viral protein. So the virus has turned off the host, it's got the whole translation apparatus to its own use. Many viruses do this in different ways. Now, when you shut off host translation by cleaving EIF4G, or if the host phosphorylates EIF2-alpha using PKR, the host knows that this is happening. And what it does is responds by making interesting structures called stress granules or P-bodies. All right? These are recently discovered areas in the cytoplasm. Whenever a cell is put under stress of some sort, it could be virus infection or serum starvation or high temperature, the cell doesn't want to make any more proteins. It wants to wait until things get better. So it puts the mRNAs into these stress granules. So for example, if you infect cells with a virus and it cleaves EIF4G or phosphorylate, you have phosphorylation of EIF2-alpha by PKR. This triggers the formation of stress granules. What the cell does is take its active polysome and shunts them into this structure where the RNAs are kept, and this structure is made of a variety of proteins, and they can't be translated, basically. And a P-body is very similar. It takes the mRNA and puts them in these P-bodies. And the idea is that when the cell is ready to resume translation, it can actually deconstruct these P-bodies and stress granules and resume mRNA translation. As you might guess, almost every virus that's been looked at antagonizes the formation of these P-bodies and stress granules in some way. So for example, up here, I'm showing you the targets of polio and dengue or retrovirus and all other viruses on the formation of stress granules. We know for polio, for example, it cleaves a protein called G3BP, which is an essential structural component of the stress granule, so they can't form. And dengue does the same thing. And all these other viruses antagonize the formation of stress granules in some way. We don't know the mechanism. That's why we're just pointing at the granule here. And in similar ways, viruses interfere with the production of P-bodies. They interfere with the structural proteins that are needed to form these. Because viral mRNAs don't want to be shunted into these stress granules and P-bodies. They are translationally inactive. That would not be good for the virus. So this is a cell response, again, to infection to try and shut down infection, and the virus tries to reverse it. In cells infected with some viruses, EIF4G is cleaved. What is a consequence of this event? What is a polysome? A polysome is an mRNA with many ribosomes on it translating protein. So the way translation works, you don't just have one ribosome moving down an mRNA, you have many of them, so you can be very efficient. All right, the answer to this one is, well, it's some fusion between number 2 and number 5, okay? So EIF4G cleavage, what's the consequence? The N-terminal 4E binding site is separated from the rest of the molecule. That's right. Cap-dependent translation is inhibited, yes, because the cap binding protein can no longer recruit the ribosome. Stress granules form, that's true. There is no effect on polio mRNA translation. Cleavage of 4G has no effect on polio translation because it doesn't need a cap, it has an iris. So they're all true. So if you pick two, you are correct, but everything else is correct as well. All right, the last thing I want to tell you about is something we'll revisit later when we talk about immune responses, and these are microRNAs. And as you probably know, these are encoded within our genome and that of many, many cells. They're transcribed as precursors and then processed by enzymes in the cell to 21 nucleotide RNAs, which then target mRNAs. And we have over 1,000 encoded in our genome, and they're very important for regulating our own protein synthesis. They can either degrade mRNAs or inhibit their translation, as you can see here. And they target the 3' UTR. So I'm talking about them today because they're really targeting translation. They make an mRNA untranslatable in some way. They function in a complex that's made up of the microRNA, the target, and a couple of cell proteins, Argonaut, Dicer, and TRBP. And they're typically complementary to the 3' untranslated region. And how complementary they are depends on controls whether the mRNA is degraded or translation is replaced. So here we have the 3' end of a messenger RNA. Here's the end of the open reading frame, the poly A. And the microRNA binding sites are typically a short distance from the 3' ORF. And they base pair in two segments like this with a bulge in between. And this region here, this 3' complementarity, the extent of complementarity depends on whether the microRNA will induce degradation of the target message or inhibit translation. And so since we've learned all about how translation works here, you can appreciate this now. You have microRNPs that are proteins with the microRNAs bound to the 3' non-coding region. These can somehow inhibit cap association, the association of the ribosome with the 5' cap. They can also inhibit elongation. And what's not shown here is that you typically need multiple microRNAs bound. A single one is probably not enough to inhibit any RNA. So in addition to degrading the RNA, they can directly inhibit translation either at the initiation step or the elongation step. So cellular microRNAs can impact virus infection. There's actually a very interesting example of a liver-specific microRNA that's required for hepatitis C virus replication. So most of the time we think of microRNAs as inhibiting viral replication. In this case, the microRNA is needed, and that may explain why the virus replicates preferentially in the liver. Many microRNAs in our cells regulate virus infections by targeting genes that the virus requires for replication. We'll talk more about this in the immune response lecture. And I want to tell you about one specific microRNA called miR-141. This is induced during infection with enteroviruses, and it inhibits the translation of EIF4E. EIF4E is the cap-binding protein. The virus doesn't care about EIF4E. Who cares about EIF4E? The cell. So this is a way for the virus to shut off, another way to shut off cellular translation by inducing this microRNA that shuts off EIF4E. So the microRNA is probably around to regulate EIF4E during normal cellular life, and the virus has somehow evolved to take advantage of this. Now, there's a very controversial area of virology, and that is virus-encoded microRNAs. They've been found in just a few of all the viruses that we know about. Herpes viruses have a ton of them. Some have been found in polyomas, adenos, and a few other viruses. Retroviruses, is not clear whether these are bona fide microRNAs or not. And we're really not sure yet what these are doing. The story is just beginning to emerge. But in general, we think that these virus-encoded microRNAs interfere with host responses to virus infection. They block apoptosis. They allow the viruses to escape immune responses. And as we will see when we talk about viruses that persist for a long period of time, these viral microRNAs probably allow the viruses to do that. They allow them to escape immune defenses and be in the host forever. That's why you guys all have 10 or 12 viruses in you at any given time, in part because of these microRNAs.